Arthritis is no joke, from the pain and stiffness in the joints across the body to the inflammation that never ceases. Being able to manage it and even improve the majority, if not all, of the symptoms with one supplement would be pretty impressive. And aren't we just in luck? Because such a supplement does exist. So let's discuss the science, because there's been at least 30 studies that have looked into this anti-arthritis effect. So we'll go over it briefly, the mechanisms by which it works, and then go into the clinical data detailing all the ways that it improves arthritis, including some details that you've probably never heard before, even if you've watched other content on curcumin. Curcumin is a molecule found inside the turmeric spice, and that's been extensively researched on its benefits, some that I've covered in the past, but there's been a ton of work in relation to rheumatoid and osteoarthritis. Curcumin works through a number of mechanisms, and I'd like to get into some of the detail in some of these mechanisms in other content because they deserve their own deep dives. But for now, know that curcumin molecule reduces the expression or the production of key inflammation molecules like interleukins, interferons, tumor necrosis factor. Essentially, curcumin stops these molecules from being produced by, if we take a short stroll through your cells, binding a protein complex called inhibitor of kappa beta kinase complex. We'll abbreviate it as IKK. Curcumin is able to stop specific proteins that branch off this complex from binding the genes that produce the inflammatory molecules that we just went over. So the interleukins, interferons, and so on. Normally, if these proteins were to peel off and bind these genes would be red and more of these inflammatory molecules would be produced, leading to a stronger immune response and more pain signals. Obviously, not what we want in arthritis. Curcumin attempts to stop that from happening. But beyond the direct anti-inflammatory effects, it can also inhibit the overactivity of synovial cells in the joints. These cells are responsible for the production of synovial fluid, a necessary component to a healthy joint. However, if they are overactive, they can also contribute to inflammation and pain. Curcumin quiets them from an overactive state to a normally active state. There's also some wildly cool mechanisms curcumin has on bone in osteoarthritis especially, but I'll leave that for dedicated content. Tell me if you're interested, because there's so much more depth here that I'm not mentioning. Let's move on to what you really care about if you have arthritis. What does curcumin do to your function, your well-being, your joint pain? Well, let's get into that. First, let me introduce the analysis that we'll be leaning on. In this analysis, the researchers pooled 30 randomized controlled trials together into a wonderful meta-analysis. I say it's wonderful because I've seen few meta-analyses that have been performed this well. I usually do some level of secondary inspection by opening some of the individual included studies and make sure that they did certain things correctly. And the researchers did everything really well. First of all, they incorporated many databases to find all the studies that they could. They even included databases that house studies that show no effect in unpublished data. This is important because without this, it biases the entire analysis to find an effect if you don't include the data that indicates no effect. They also used a massive list of keywords to find all the studies that they could, and they even used studies in Chinese as well, which increases the pool of available studies. This was all very well done. Okay, enough babbling about the methodology, let's discuss the results. First off, they looked at some inflammation metrics like C-reactive protein or CRP, and C-reactive protein is an overall inflammation metric released by your liver. It rises in response to body inflammation. If you have higher CRP levels, your bodily inflammation is generally heightened. Here's that data. I'm going to walk you through how to read this, but if you're already familiar or you just don't care, then skip to this timestamp. On the left side are the study names, and then all the numbers in the middle are the CRP values extracted from each study, from the curcumin condition in each study called the experimental, and from the non-curcumin consuming group called the control. Now, I won't go over the mean, the standard deviation, and all that jazz. I have a course that explains all that if you're interested in learning how to analyze studies for yourself. However, To the right of the numbers, we see green boxes and a black diamond. Those are the graphical representation of the numbers. Much easier to read. See the line above zero? That's the mark for no detected effect of curcumin. If the individual green boxes, which represent the study results, move to the left, it indicates an effect of curcumin. And if they move to the right, it means there's a likely worse effect with curcumin. Finally, you'll note the risk of bias on the very right. This is another analysis that researchers are often required to do. It's a standardized system where they report the risk of bias across a number of measurements of potential bias. Generally, the more green that you see, the lower the potential bias. However, you'll rarely ever see all green because in analyses of these sizes, you'll inevitably include some studies that have a higher risk of bias, and some risk is unavoidable. There's more to say on this topic, but we've got some results to get to, and I'd like to acknowledge one more thing that the researchers did really well. Again, skip to this timestamp if you really don't care. I can't help myself. I just like highlighting great work, especially since I'm often so critical. So notice that this Amalaraj study shows up twice, and so does the Jacob study. They show up twice because they had two separate intervention groups, meaning two different groups were given curcumin. Instead of choosing one group and ignoring the other, researchers are allowed to add both groups to the analysis as long as they follow certain rules. One, the groups have to be distinct. So you can't say the same group of participants in that study were exposed to two different concentrations of curcumin just at different times. Those are dependent groups because it's the same group of people just at two different times. However, in this case, it has two completely different groups of people given different amounts of curcumin. The second thing is that the researchers of the analysis have to do is split the comparison group. What does that mean? There's only one control group, yet two interventions, so curcumin groups. As a result, you can't compare both intervention groups against the same control group because it artificially inflates the results. There's some complexity that I won't go over for now. So either the researchers can choose to only include one intervention group from the study, although there are two, or they can split the control group, which means that they assign half the control group to be compared against one curcumin group and the other half to be compared against the other curcumin group. This effectively rebalances the results. I can't tell you how many analyses fail to do that. It's not necessarily a deal breaker, but it does reduce the confidence in the results that they're actually accurate if they're on the edge between statistically significant or not. Anyway, I double-checked a few of these comparisons by opening the individual studies and was very pleasantly surprised. These researchers nailed it. Serious kudos to them. I realize you might be wondering, who in the world cares, dude? And from my perspective, understanding this stuff is part of a complete education. I don't believe just telling people the answer, but rather showing them the train of thought. And it's important for people to see the background work that goes into this. Referencing abstracts runs wayfully short of the necessary work. Anyway, I promise I'll stop with the statistics, at least for the most part. Let's rejoin the 99% that skipped to the timestamp. So, based on these data on CRP levels, the black diamond, which corresponds to the average value across all the studies combined, curcumin does reduce the inflammatory marker CRP. This is confirmed statistically as well. There's another important thing to say about this along with all the other measures, but I'll address that at the end. Let's move on. Another measure is rheumatoid factor, or RF. This is an antibody that binds to our own tissues and identifies it as other, or not of self, which promotes a strong inflammatory response by the immune system. Now, RF especially binds what's known as the Fc region of an IgG antibody. The dominant type of antibody in your body is IgG. And there's a section that is called the Fc region. Now, RF will bind to that Fc region and create a complex. In doing so, the immune cells are drawn to that region, leading to an inflammatory cascade, as seen in rheumatoid arthritis. So, what happens when we consume curcumin? Well, let's look. We can see the four studies, or more accurately, the four arms of two studies, by the black diamond clearly to the left, indicating a benefit of curcumin, confirmed statistically. Now, I'd also add that these results are remarkably consistent, with zero heterogeneity for those in the know. Okay, so across two inflammation and arthritis markers, curcumin provides a benefit. But we're not just interested in inflammation. We want to understand if there are functional improvements. Can people move more easily, experience fewer symptoms, and so on? So let's look at that. For that, we'll rely on the DAS28 test. That stands for the disease activity score in 28 joints. The higher the value of this score, the greater one's pain, so swollen joints. So the lower the score, the better. Looking at those data, we again see curcumin provides benefit, again confirmed statistically. Now, I do wish they did do further analysis by picking out the least risk of bias studies and seeing if that would change the results, because you might notice that the three studies or conditions that are the lowest risk of bias show no effect. It would be nice at least to tease that out. However, looking at some other measures like the WOMAC score, which is another test of functional ability, the higher quality studies confirm curcumin's effect. Okay, we're not done yet, because there's a few important things that you should know before we close this out. Before we get to those, there's also additional information comparing curcumin to other joint support molecules like glucosamine, chondroitin, and more. I'll be covering that along with the optimal dosing of curcumin and more in the extended version of this video that you're watching, which, if you've been here for a while, you know it's all included in the Physionic Insiders, along with access to all my work and much, much more. You can join via the link in the description. I hope to see you there. Now, what's so important? Well, for one, all the comparisons that we've looked at are against a control group. Remember, non-curcumin. But that doesn't mean it's a pure comparison. That could be a drug, it could be another supplement, and so on. I mean that if we want to get a real sense of curcumin's effects, we need to look at curcumin versus something like a placebo, a true non-curcumin comparison, not another active ingredient. Fortunately, the researchers split the controls apart and isolated the studies only comparing against placebo. And here are the results. The top comparison is against placebo only, and we're looking at that WOMAC measure that I mentioned earlier, a measure of pain. Overall, it seems curcumin again confirms in a more pure comparison that it is effective against arthritis pain. However, if you ease your eyes down a bit, they also compare against conventional pain medication called NSAIDs. To be fair, there's only one study, but it's a very low risk of bias study, and there's no advantage of curcumin in that comparison. However, is that a bad thing? Likely not. It should be interpreted that curcumin is not more effective, but is as effective as conventional pain relief medication. So that's not bad at all. Another important point here to look at is the effect sizes, as in, sure, there's an effect, but how big is the effect? Is it worth my while? The answer is a bit surprising. For example, that DAS28 test that we looked at earlier showed a 1.06 point reduction compared to all controls. But what is the scale of the DAS28? Is it a 2-point scale or is it a 50-point scale? It turns out it's a 10-point scale. So it's about a 10% improvement with curcumin. Not bad, but not earth-shattering. That said, what happens when we look at the pure comparison? There, the effect is again relatively mild, although it does seem to improve across multiple different types of problems like swelling, pain, stiffness, and so on. However, on metrics of inflammation, curcumin has some pretty fantastic effects. For example, the rheumatoid factor is reduced by around 50 points, which would completely shift a person from one whole category of disease to another, from, let's say, severe to moderate arthritis, as one example. That's really amazing. So where does that leave everything? Curcumin, yes, or a no for arthritis? Well, it seems clear that curcumin supplementation mildly improves rheumatoid and osteoarthritis symptoms. The effect size on the clinical measures isn't huge, but it is widespread. On the other hand, some of the inflammation measures do show pretty significant improvements. I'd also add that curcumin was shown, with limited evidence, to improve arthritis symptoms on par with non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs, which is also quite impressive. Now, if you're suffering from arthritis symptoms, it's probably worthwhile to consider curcumin. And something else to consider is this next video that I have linked for you. Thanks for tuning in, and all the best to you. Bye.